Mm-hmm. You didn't arrive with Mr. Clinton, did you?
No, Mr. Clinton came on his own, I think.
He did.
Oh, Robin, really.
As in the sense of getting here.
Yes, of course.
Oh, baby, who's your daddy? Who loves you?
What about the problem of travelling nowadays, the airport security? Do you have
it's a bit difficult now. You know, in the old days, it used to be, oh, get on the plane. Come on, get on the plane. Oh, what's that? Oh, that's a gun. Okay, get on the plane. Now it's hardcore. You know, it's basically they take away everything from you. You know, first of all, if you're having meat on the plane, you don't have a knife because that could be a weapon. So it's like... It's like the quest for Firefly. I'm sorry, sir. And they take away things like nail clippers because that could be turned into a weapon. What do they think? You're going to be going, open the cockpit door! Or the bitch loses a hangnail. Come on! It's, you know, they have... You all right, coach? Oh, dear God! And I grew up, you know, I live in San Francisco, so when you go through the metal detector, there are some pierced people there. You know? Take out your keys, oh, tip of the iceberg. You know, it's a bizarre thing. When you see a girl with a pierced tongue, I asked this girl, I said, why did you pierce your tongue? And she said, it increases your sexual stimulation. Yeah. That's all right, my darling. Don't be afraid. Something simple. But the security is tight now. Yeah, it's a bizarre funny. Thing. And we now have, you know, the Office of Homeland Security, which is, you know...
What's that?
Well, it's basically in America, it's to watch over and warn us when things bad are going to happen. Because every so often, Rumsfeld comes out and goes, I don't know where. I don't know when. But something awful is going to happen. That's all for today. No further questions. Like, what is it, the Central Intuitive Agency? I'm getting a feeling of a man wearing a shoe that hisses. And well, all they've learned so far is what the FBI can share with us is beware of people who take flight school and are interested in takeoff and landing, number one. Number two, anyone who gets on a plane with a shoe that goes, warning, you over there. And now people are wide awake on that. Used to be on the, you know, the red-eye flight. They would get on the plane, take whatever medication they could, and wake up in Russia going, this isn't Cleveland. And now they basically, everyone's wide awake looking for anyone ordering hummus. Cleveland! You know, and they have, you know, this thing of, they say there's no racial profiling, but...
No.
A little woman will come on, a sweet little southern stewardess, and go, ladies and gentlemen, before we get on flat five, I just want to read off a list of names. These are random bag checks. These are totally random. And I'm just going to read off a list of names. Hassan bin Singh. Hafan bin Leib. Judy Smith. 14 Arabs and a blonde, and every black man and every Hispanic man in the room is going, thank you, God. We're off the list now, sweet Lord Almighty. Gone away now. And it's always a difficult thing because pilots are always, you know, the pilots used to come on with that whole Chuck Yeager rap where they go, hey, everybody, I've just had a few cocktails. Let's take this sucker down to the end of the runway and see what it'll do. Now they come on, they're very loving, and they go, hey, I love all of you. Stewardess comes out and goes, in case of a cabin seizure, a small Louisville slugger will fall from the ceiling. Grab with both hands, aim for the assailant's head, knees, and groin, and keep hitting. Well, basically, it's home defense, just like you had during World War II.
Well, you mean Dad's Army?
Yes, Dad's Army. Dad's Army. Old men with a colostomy bag and a pitchfork. I captured Rudolf Hess personally. I threw my colostomy bag and covered him in shite. Go! Get out of that fucker, and I'm talking about the plane. Go! Step away.
Oh, God.
Is it true?
What?
Is it true that Winston Churchill was sometimes so drunk that they had a guy from the BBC do some of his favorite
speeches?
That's
apparently been reported.
Really? It that's wonderful. The guy who did Winnie the Pooh. So he was going, we will fight him on the beaches, in the air, on the land. Eeyore and Tigger. But God bless, sir. You have Tony Blair now, sir.
Yeah, we do.
God bless.
Indeed. And you have President Bush.
Yes. Let's drink a full one.
Oh, there we go. A mighty man.
A mighty man.
A mighty man, sir.
Just don't ask him to spell.
No.
I love watching Bush watch Tony speak, because he's going, I can't spell most of those words. You just see him going, you know, some men are born great, some achieve greatness, some get it as a graduation gift. It's like, he's George II, the boy king. No one realizes.
Let's now come to the purpose of your visit.
The purpose of our visit, sir.
It is, up until now, I think it was Billy Connolly who held the record for talking longest without a question prompting it.
Just a stimulus, sir.
And knowing that the two of you are great friends, I wonder who stops talking first.
Oh, it's difficult to know, you know.
Hey,
yeah. Once you get up there and there are people playing dead cats, you can't stop. For me, I get up there with him and it's wild because he just goes. He'll tell you stories about, do you do any Harry? And once I get off the plane in Scotland, I need subtitles. It's very hard. What? How they can invent golf. Oh, they can have a couple of Guinness and then the next thing you know, here's my idea for a sport. I knock a ball into a gopher hole. Oh, you mean like pool? No, forget pool. Not with a straight stick. A little broken stick. I whack a ball into a gopher hole. Oh, you mean like croquet? No, not croquet. That's a pussy sport. I put the hole hundreds of yards away. Oh, kind of like a bowling alley. Oh, no way. Shit in the way. I put stuff in the way like trees and bushes. So you whack the ball and you're sitting there whacking away and you feel like you're gonna have a stroke. That's what we'll call it. Because every time you hit the ball, you think you're gonna die. And right near the end, they'll put a nice flat bit with a tiny flag to give you hope. And they'll put a pool and a sandbox to grab your ball. You do this one time. Oh no, 18 damn times!
The question is, the first question.
And that holds the record for the first question. In the middle of the interview, the producer's like.
The question is.
Edwina on line one.
What is he doing there?
You don't figure in the diaries, do you? The Edwina Curry diaries.
Oh, the Edwina Curry. Yes. I hope not.
My transatlantic adventure, perhaps?
An adventure weekend with Edwina Curry. More like Wild Kingdom, really.
I took off the beeper collar just long enough to find John again.
Let the dogs out. We'll find her. Come on, boy. Come along, let Edwina go now. Come on, tell her. Even Prince Charles is going, it's all right. We'll find her by Tuesday. And there's Bill going, call me. Come on, don't be afraid.
But the question is...
Yes. We'll see if you can get to it by the end.
We'll see.
The question is...
This is a wonderful manic stand-up performer there, anyway, with this sort of extraordinary flow of laughter. And then in the film that you're playing now, 1 Hour Photo, you're this very silent man. You're totally, utterly bland.
Yes.
And faceless, almost.
Yeah, that was the purpose, to actually do the exact opposite of what you've just seen.
And you managed it incredibly well.
Yeah, I think because I could do what I've just done and what I do on stage and... have all of that energy and then let all of that go and be this man, like you said, who is almost faceless, who's so bland that he lives vicariously through other people's photographs. And that's why I did it, to be in a movie that's kind of so unsettling because of that stillness, I think, and it takes people by surprise, which is good.
It's a very sinister film.
Yes,
But in the end, we can't talk about the ending of it, but it's on many levels. It's not quite what you expect.
Yeah, it always takes strange turns where you think, oh, no, he's that, and you go, oh, no, it's something else. And even the very end, which people think, oh, don't, and then it takes another turn.
The ending's brilliant.
Yeah, it keeps you always going... It takes you one way and always takes another turn, which is good. That's why I loved it when I read it. And when I saw the videos, Mark Romanek was a video director. And in videos, he had done so many different things visually. I went, I've got to do this movie because it combines both.
the visuals and this great script, I went, this is, you know, really interesting work.
Well, in it, then, you play Cy, who was the guy at the one-hour photo
camera. Yeah, the man who basically sees the pictures of, you know, you and the thong. Not you.
Not me.
That's a lovely picture, though.
It is.
I like the one in the chaps better. But, you know, it is that he basically develops people's pictures, and he's been kind of fascinated with this one family. A very, like the InStyle poster family, beautiful family, beautiful husband and wife and a child and a beautiful house, everything that's a total opposite of what his life is. And, you know, that's kind of...
And then the fantasy goes to a degree where he imagines that he's their uncle and he imagines he can walk into their house.
Yeah, that which he's basically part of their family.
Which is this sequence now.
Let's right. Look at
this. It's about loneliness. It's about wanting to be remembered, too, isn't it?
Yeah, the thing that there's a great line in the movie where he says, with family pictures, it's that someone cared enough about me to take my picture. I exist, and it's a moment in time, a happy moment. You know, very few times you take pictures of Uncle Pete going, it's that moment where you really do, especially when you look at old photographs. Most of the time, like when we were at the flea market in the movie, we'd take all these old pictures, and these are people who are gone, but there's a moment of them smiling and a moment of just a brief captured moment of
They're
happiness.
They're incredibly nostalgic, aren't they?
And yeah, very bizarre.
When you do a character like that, and what you made, what, 40 movies now?
Oh, but I don't remember now.
It's about 40. Yeah.
That and Good Will Humping.
Yeah. Good Will Humping.
The adult versions of every movie you do.
Yeah, like, but what's the key to it, to the part? In the sense that, I mean, you know, some actors say it's the walk, some say it's the...
I think it was the look. I think when you said that kind of blandness, to bland everything out, started with the hair, taking all color out of the hair, making the face so bland and so neutral that literally one day I was walking through the store, he works in like a big Save Mart, and I disappeared, and then Mark went, that's what I want. I want him to blend in so that outside of that store, he's lost. He's like a, you know, he's a fish or a chameleon going, what color do I become now? And that's why he would fantasize about someone else's life.
You also did it for me, the shoes.
Everyone, a woman actually complimented me on my acting and said, thank you, but that was the sound man. Because the shoes have that kind of...
That's like sort of, as if you're treading on, some sort of small furry
animal. Yeah, it was the walk combined with some small furry animal. What are you doing, dear? Don't be afraid, wear live fur.
Don't wear fur.
It's always strange, but yeah, that was part of it, the walk, the look. It all helps. I think it's kind of inside. And then the loneliness of a guy who's so isolated that he would think that pictures are the way to achieve another life.
Yeah. Have you ever been lonely in your childhood? Were you lonely?
Maybe. I was an only child, so yeah. So. For a long time, it was just me and the puppet. But it was, you know, it was a bit of a, you know, an unusual time. People go, is that why you're so hairy, Romy? It was, an isolated shot. It's a time delay thing where people go, oh, but it was, you know, I could go back and use some of that as a sense memory of that.
Talking about being hairy, you once said you were too furry to be a leading
man. I was actually hit on by Coco the gorilla.
Were you?
You know, she can sign, and it was amazing because they took me to meet her because it was part of this program to raise money for a new habitat. So she signs to her trainer, who's the blue-eyed simian, and I went, thank you. And then she signs to her trainer to do this. And I go, what is that? She wants you to lift your shirt. I lift my shirt, and she pinches both my nipples. And all of a sudden, I'm going, whoa, Missy wants to play. And then she grabs me by the hand and starts to take me in the back room, and the trainer's going, Coco, no. And the trainer's going, I can't help you. And all of a sudden, I think that it's like the crocodile hunter's going to walk out and go, oh, danger, danger, danger. She wants to bump uglies with him. Watch out, boys and girls. She's going to do the bone dance. Be careful. Going to be some interesting little babies this fall. But it was interesting. She hit on me. She was like grooming me, like, oh. It's hard when you have this much hair. I've seen mosquitoes take their own life. You just see them go, hard day.
Where did this humor come from? Somebody must describe this, your performance as being Touretic.
Yeah, voluntary Tourette's.
Voluntary Tourette's.
Yeah! You know, like, it is a bit like that. I mean, there is that thing where I'll cross over the line sometimes. Obviously, today I did, but then you had that look like, oh, do stop.
I
know, but there was that look like, will we be getting to the question soon? But it is that thing of where you go off on things And you sometimes you get you'll see a moment and you go, oh, and you just pursue it, and it's like a little bit like possession. And it happens once in a while.
But wasn't the moment just comes, there's nothing pre-planned or anything.
Sequential. Or it's actually more like a fractal, but then we're getting even Stephen Hawking's going, don't go there now. I called his house one day. Hello, this is Stephen Hawking. Yes, I'd like to leave a message. No, this is Stephen Hawking. But it is that idea that it's just kind of, if A, then two. You know, you kind of, you know, you jumpstart and go to different places, usually from some weird synapse firing.
I watched your last Broadway show, which in July, live on Broadway, which has been recorded for HBO. I mean, that was a truly astonishing performance. Because, for, I mean, for 2 hours, I mean, you stand there, you seem to have no... There's no script, there's no prompt, there's nothing.
No, you can't really.
But you don't tell long anecdotes either. I mean, it's all quick fire stuff. Yeah, you become 1,000 different people.
Because that was the way I started off. I started off in a club where usually you start off performing in bars where you can't really take the time because people go, hey, and it's, you know, what are you doing now? And those are usually people who own the club. So I started to develop a style that was just very much like, you know, synaptic, quick firing, moving, so they never really had a chance to lock on as a target. And then it started to develop as being this kind of idea of taking an idea and going with it and then breaking away. And that's been kind of the style.
So it is extemporized to that extent that you...
Yeah, it starts off, usually the first 5 minutes are like kind of getting, especially when different cities, I would start off talking about the city and then go off from there.
But you said in the research that your influences were, one or two, were English comics.
Oh, yeah, Peter Sellers, amazingly.
Really?
So. Yeah, I mean, in terms of comic acting, I think for me the best movie was... Oh, it doesn't get any better than Dr. Strangelove, because here's... You know, all these distinct characters. I mean, besides Dr. Strangelove, which is the ultimate Henry Kissinger. But
I never understood that movie till now.
Hi, Mr. Kissinger. I've seen all of your bombs. Could you sign them? But it's the idea of him and all of those characters for me was the best. And you know, I one of the few people in America who had copies of the Goon Show.
Natty, how did you get across that lake? I walked across those stones. Those aren't stones, those are alligators. I wonder why my legs were getting shorter. That's an explosion that can only be heard by an idiot. What was that noise? Oh.
Those are the things I kind of grew up with. And Jonathan Winters, but you know, yes. Those are the my influence. And Peter Cook and Dudley Moore.
Are you influenced by them, as well?
Oh, yeah, and, you know, Derek and Clive, but we can't talk about that.
No, we can't talk about that.
Not without rubber wrapping. But, you know, those were great comics.
You also played the clubs there, too, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, I played in London, which was great, the comic strip, the Comedy Store. I don't know if there is a comic strip. No, Robin, wrong. And then I played a club in Windsor. Lenny Henry said, come out and play Windsor, which was a great idea, till I walked on stage and, you know, worst night of my comedy life. This is all you heard in the audience. It was, ladies and gentlemen, Robin Williams! And all you heard was... But don't you... Not even like, get off! It was just like this. Like. And that's like that old thing where you see the comic where he's on stage and I'm sweating more like Marlon Brando after Thai food. It's like... You know, my lower track is going, should we release now, Robin? If you fart, you might get a laugh and get off stage. It was the most frightening night, but, you know, it was good to have in the back of your memory. It was
absolutely
a great thing.
What about the balance of your life now? I mean, do you feel you mainly do movies, of course? You've got three out this year.
Yeah, I think I'll continue to do films, hopefully.
But do you feel you have to, every so often, get out and explode all this energy on stage?
Yeah, I think...
It's a must, is it?
Yeah, I think... Now, I did the last stand-up before. This one was about 16 years ago, but I've realized that it's important to do... For me, as you know, it's cheaper than therapy, number one. And number two, there's so much to talk about. You know, you have a lot of things going on in the world. Just the Pope alone, when he's got a it always looks like he just wants to fart and they keep pushing him around. And the guy behind him is going, I got your seats, no worry. All I do is tell him, the Vatican Museum. Welcome to the history of the Vatican. When he's going around, you ever see him in the Pope Mobile? I just want to put bingo balls in there.
Questa era la donna che stava a fare. Play ball!
well. And he wears clothes that even Liberace would go, oh, please. What is this, ermine? Well, nice purse, hello, but it's on fire.
I think there might be any Catholic viewers still watching. No?
Yeah, no Catholic. I'll never go to Ireland. Don't get off the plane. Yeah, don't get off in Rome. Two nuns that follow you going, I see him.
You said that the laughter is a bit of a therapy for you. Is it also, has it been an aphrodisiac?
Oh, very much.
Very much.
In the old days, oh, yes, sir. Yeah. Nothing as close to an orgasm as laughter, sir.
Really?
Same face. That's not funny. Oh, come on now. But I think, yeah, it helped a little.
Is it the best medicine?
Oh, I think so. It's an enema for the soul, really. I think it helps. I think it can really be a good thing to keep. It kind of releases. It releases a great energy in people. You can talk about things that are quite sometimes painful and get across with comedy is something that you couldn't talk just straight at, because people would go, oh, please, don't talk about that. Especially now with what's going on. You know, it's, you know, we're considering every day, it's like George is going, we've got to go after Sodom. Sodom, Sodom, Sodom. He tried to kill my father. Well, why don't you get a posse, Lumpy? Let's go. Come on.
Here we go.
You know how, if you want to do an impression of his father, all you have to do is take, well, what you do is you take John Wayne and tighten his ass. And there you have George W., the first. There he is. Not going to say it. Can't use. No syntax. What are you, Yoda? Come on.
Yeah, friend, good, yeah.
None have economy, bad.
Good, yeah.
You know, I think it's, that's why I do comedy, just for the last few seconds, because it's like, all right, yeah, that was nice.
You make a serious point.
Serious
make
points. You can talk. Well, you can dabble in them. You know?
Dabble in them. Robin Williams, thank you very much indeed.
Mr. Parkinson, thank you,
Robin
sir.
Robin Williams.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, well. I enjoyed that.
Thank you, sir. Salud.
Even coming out. Oh, great. I know him for so long.
Yes, he is a good man.
I forgot it.
Crazy cuckoo world we're building now.